Good morning, YouTube. Happy Sunday. Hope you're having a wonderful Sunday today. It's your girl, Miss Honey. It's going to be another beautiful day today, you guys. Today we're going to be talking about embracing weakness. Comes from James 4 and 10, morning version of James 4 and 10 is the New King James Version. And then the evening version of James 4:10 is the New Living Translation. James 4 and 10 reads, "Humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord, and he will lift you up." The text says, "Do you ever find yourself suddenly aware of your own glaring weaknesses? Aware that if left up to your own good works, you wouldn't stand a chance of attaining salvation? We should find great comfort in the fact that we are nothing without salvation in Christ Jesus. When we know our weakness, we are more aware of our need for His strength. When we put ourselves in a position of humility and ask Him to be strong where we are weak, He is delighted to help. You don't have to ask a knight in shining armor twice to rescue his princess." Our prayer for this morning is, "Jesus, I humbly acknowledge that I could not rescue myself. Thank you that I live a life that you have redeemed and are restoring. Lift me up in strength today." The evening version of James 4 and 10, New Living Translation reads, "Humble yourselves before the Lord, and he will lift you up in honor." The text says, thankfully, this is the evening, thankfully, God made a way for us to be united with him. Despite impatience, selfishness, anger, and pride, God deeply cares for us and patiently sustains us with steady, faithful, adoring love. I'm going to read it again because I want us to be clear about what is being said here. I want it to soak down into the marrow of our own bones, okay? I want us to lock it in. Thankfully, God made a way for us to be united with him. Despite impatience, selfishness, anger, and pride, God deeply cares for us. Come on now. God deeply cares for us and patiently sustains us with steady, steady, faithful, adoring love. Okay. It goes on to say, amazingly, God's love even goes beyond this to embrace and transform our weakness. When we yield it to him. Weakness isn't something to be feared or hidden. Weakness submitted to God allows the power of Christ to work in and through us. Right? Our evening prayer says, "God, some evenings I feel so tired and disappointed. Thank you for allowing me to be weak. I know that you can work best with my weary heart. And so I give it over to you tonight and ask for your renewal." Our question for ourselves today, Sunday, May 23rd, is prayerfully submit your weakness to God so that through him you can be strong. His transformative love is waiting to graciously restore you. Okay? So not really a question, I guess. It's more of a statement. Submit your weakness to God so that through him you can be strong. His transformative love is waiting graciously to restore you. What I wanted to say about this is, for me, I can connect with this devotion today because I've spent my entire life really being a fixer, being the strong one. Most of it is inherent in me. I inherently am an individual that is resilient and tough, you know. I'm hardworking, I'm a go-getter, I don't really ask a lot from others. I tend to get up early, get started on what I want to do, and get it done. Right? But I will say that some of my most profound moments with God, with the Spirit, Christ Jesus, and feeling his amazing love, is when I have yielded all of that pseudo strength. You know, none of us are as strong as God is, obviously, but just let it go. Just let go that need to be the strong one. You know what I'm saying? That, I won't even say for some people that it's a need. For me personally, I just always was, you know, a very resilient individual. Even as a child, I played by myself very well. And I wasn't easily shaken, you know. Crisis happened. I knew I was an avid reader and all of that, and I would jump in and make things right, make things better. I remember one time we had a grease fire in the kitchen, and my sister was cooking at the time, and she's the oldest child. And, you know, I had read and I had been through all the Smokey the Bear, you know, meeting in the gym, and they were doing fire safety, and they'd have a Smokey the Bear costume on a fireman or something, and they tell you what to do. Well, I remembered what to do, and I grabbed the fire extinguisher and put the fire out, you know, and it didn't scare me. I wasn't shaking. I knew what to do, and I did it. And I kind of became known for that, you know, the kind of person that you could leave, you know. I was a good babysitter and that type of thing, because I just wasn't a panicker. I had just a lot of fortitude, I guess. I wasn't a nervous Nelly. So that was just my way of being, you know. And then after a while, the older you get, people put these labels on you, and then you aspire to those labels, you know what I mean? You aspire to uphold those labels, right? And so people say, you strong, we don't have to worry about you, we don't have to, you know, I know you ain't thinking about that, I know you don't care about that type of thing, I know we didn't have to worry about you. And then you take on those labels, I guess. Like I said, you aspire to uphold them. And you find, oh, they know I ain't worried about it. They know I ain't thinking about it. They know I don't need nothing. They know they ain't got to worry about checking on me. Right? And then you move along in your life a little bit more. You get a little bit older. And you realize you spent your the bulk of your life with no one else really worried about you. No one else really thinking that they had to focus on you. You know, they had to focus their prayers on you, or their extra teaching or extra tutelage. They They don't have to worry about you because you got it. And you carrying yourself like nobody has to worry about me because I got it. Right? But there's something relaxing. There's something calming. There's something restorative about showing a vulnerable side, especially to our Lord and Savior. Okay? There's something cathartic about going to Him and bending at your waist and wailing from your belly that you love Him and that you need Him and that you cannot do it without Him. There's something very therapeutic about it. Just releasing it and letting it go. Okay? You ain't got to be strong with the Lord. You got to be strong in the Lord. Come on now. But when you go to Christ and say, God, I am so afraid. I'm scared, Lord. I'm afraid. I don't know what to do here. I need help. I need guidance. Now, I'm not talking about self-deprecation. God, I'm so dumb. I'm so stupid. I should have known better. No, 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 no. You won't have to take none of those welcome mat, whipping boy, self-deprecating, self-mutilating. God don't want none of that. He don't co-sign any of that. He does co-sign humility. Okay? He does co-sign your relinquishing your need to hold the reins and control. Right? But He loves you. He considers you beautiful. He considers you fearfully and wonderfully made. He doesn't do all that self-deprecating, putting yourself down. It doesn't move Him for you to come with false humility. Okay? What moves Him is you coming hat in hand and saying, Lord, I cannot do this without You. Forgive me, Father, for thinking that I could do this all by myself and not relying on You, not calling on You. For usurping my will over Yours. Forgive me, Lord. But I'm confused. I don't know how to do it. I don't understand Him. I don't understand them. I am not sure how to figure this out, Father. I need Your help. And when you get that cathartic response, when you get that therapeutic outcome where you just feel better, you just feel lighter, and ironically, now you feel stronger. Okay? That's the irony of it, right? To reveal yourself in a place of weakness actually makes you stronger. Okay? Wrap your head around that. Right? But when you get that return from it, you'll then begin to crave it. You'll then begin to see that it's not you against the world, right? It is God for you, right? And empowering you to live your purpose out in this world, but to live it out in love and in kindness, to live it out in such a way that people, that you are adding to this world and not just taking from it, to live it out in such a way where people can see you and they themselves, or see you as an example and they themselves can grow. And that means seeing you in a position of strength, and seeing you take a position of weakness by humbling yourself and saying, hey, I'm scared. I'm scared too. I'm afraid too. I'm unsure as well. But here's what I've done. I've gone before the Father and I've prayed. I've let him know that I'm afraid. I've let him know that I do not know which way to go. I let him know that I am not sure. And in his comfort of me, in his empathy, in his compassion, God has shown me the way out. He's shown me the way through. He's given me an answer. He's given me an idea. Come on now. Come on. Let me just tell you, this is from my perspective. Okay? This is me telling you what I know. This is me telling you what I know, right? You cannot go through this world thinking that you are an island. That you, no matter what people have called you and said, you the strongest person I know. You the most level-headed and even-keeled. You the smartest and yada, yada, yada. Because they want you to take the reins, because they want you to take the lead, and because they want you to take the hit a lot of times. Sometimes people really do feel that way, but a lot of times people tell you these things because they want you to go ahead and do it. They want you to live up to the label that they've put on you. Ignoring your own frailness, ignoring your own weaknesses, ignoring your own need for hugs. To be checked on, to be fed. You okay? You all right? You need anything? Can I help you? You need that too. Strong person, strong friend. But when we go to God and we say, Lord, I'm tired, I'm exhausted. He says, rest, my child, rest. It's okay, rest. Lord, I'm afraid, I'm scared. He says, fear not, my child, okay? His response is, let me help you. Let me hold you. Let me reassure you. Let me nurture you. This is the Lord's response. This is our God's response, our daddy, our father. This is his response to us. Right? And then we take that because it strengthens us, and then we go back into the fray, we go back into the village, we go back into the fight, the battle, whatever it is you got going on, right? And we tell others, are you weak? Do you feel fragile? I encourage you to go to the Father. He will comfort you. He will reinforce you. He will strengthen you, right? Through your weakness. In your weakness, he is strong, right? And you also begin to show a little bit of your fragility to others, where you say, I've done it 5 weeks in a row. I'm tired. I'm not doing it this weekend. I'm going to have to go ahead and tell you no. I know typically I say yes and you can depend on me for 500 pounds of potato salad for the church bazaar. But this year, no, I'm not going to do it. I'm not going to peel 500 potatoes and buy all the mayonnaise and relish. I'm not going to do it. Right? He'll give you strength to say no where you normally would have said yes and overtaxed and overdone and overspent. All just so people can say, man, you sure did it this year. You did. Oh, yeah, you came through this year. I can't wait for next year. Next year, I think we ought to have 1,200 pounds of potato salad. Nope, not this year. I won't be doing that. No, I think I'll pass, right? There's strength in being able to say no and not feeling bad and not making excuses. God gives you that strength. He says it's okay that you're over it, that you're tired, that it's overtaxing you. It's okay. I give you permission to say no. Okay, you guys, I don't want to talk your ear off. It's Sunday. I know you want to be with your family and eat your wonderful breakfast and enjoy this beautiful day. We're going into a holiday. And if I don't talk to you again, y'all have a wonderful holiday. But I'll be back here tomorrow morning if the Lord say the same. If the creek don't rise and the dam don't break, I'll be here. And I'll be doing our devotional again, and I'll be sharing, you know, what Miss Honey has learned in her 50 years of living, okay, and falling, and getting back up, okay? It's my prayer for you today that you are able to relinquish your cape, right? That you are able to realize that God is not man. He doesn't have the frailties of man, right? When you come to him and you reveal to him what your weaknesses are, he loves you even more. And so it's my prayer that you will have the courage to relinquish the reins, right? Of control, of strength, and humble yourselves before the Lord. And see, won't he, come on now, see, won't he pull you into his bosom, baby, and love you up, and prop you up, and fix you up, and get you revved up to go on back out there and continue to conquer, right? Knowing that he is your soft place to land. That he is a safe space for you, right? To be fragile. That's my prayer for you today. That you relinquish the reins, right? Release some control and be truly, truly humble about what your weaknesses are to Christ. And see what he do for you, baby. Okay? Go on out there and have yourself a wonderful day. I love y'all with the love of the Lord. And really, there's nothing you can do about that. Okay? Until next time, honeybees. Mwah. I'll holler.